God and to experience the love of God, to really know the love of Christ. So we need to pray for her. She's in a pretty precarious situation. But God's more than able, and he wants to show his love to her. Yes. And sometimes, you know, sadly, it just takes us coming to the end of ourselves. And, you know, the expression, I've come to the end of my rope, is what she used. But sometimes that's where we have to be before we can really turn and trust in the Lord. So, but we know that God loves her and wants to have the very best for her, to deliver her from all of these demonic attacks. Praise the Lord. So let's remember Deborah. Anybody else have a prayer request tonight? Yeah. Sally?
Remember Diane and remember Diane.
Right. Diane is dealing with some blood pressure issues and of course, Dan's knee and medication and other issues that, you know, come out of that as well. All right, James, do you have a request? Praise the Lord. Well, we'll just trust the Lord to bring some confidence and some peace and to the family and to everybody concerned. Go ahead, James. Did you have more?
Also on Joe. Joe's finally having muscle spasms. You know, the guy hurt his leg, and he's at this job. And thanks God they're showing favors and try to help him find another one. They're willing to help him find, because they said they want one better work to have. And even though he's hurt a little bit, so he's still going to. That's wonderful, but I still ask God's grace in that situation so Joe can get the necessary employment, get on. Because he was moving stuff to Evans, and James, I'm overdoing it. And I said, I could have told you, but I didn't. Because, you know, that God's willing and able, and you can handle it, and everybody's proud of you. So I told him today, I said, well, we want to make sure we pray over the little situation that you get out of that, and you'll be fine, and they'll find you something.
Amen. We'll just believe God's going to do what is needed exactly in that situation. God knows exactly what to do and how to do it to best bring about the results that Joe needs and that God knows are best for his life. Amen. Yeah.
Needs to be combated in the unseen realm now.
Amen. We just really need to take authority over it. Church needs to start declaring some things and see that come to pass. I got a text from Tim Hatton today as well, and he's going to be gone for the next couple of Wednesdays because of his work schedule, but he did ask for prayer for him, for their families, and so let's remember them as well, Tim and Leah and their extended family.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
And thanks again for the Lord's favor, because I did find my wallet, and then I did get some a significant amount of money back that I didn't even expect to work. So I was greatly reassured of what normally needed. $5 over short of what I had. It was a blessing. I didn't even, I can't thank you guys enough. I know my wallet fell out of my pocket. I know, and the guy knew me that happened, dude, brought that back to Joe. I didn't expect that. It was great. And I didn't lose any valuables. So
what is lost is found. Praise
yeah.
the Lord.
Yeah, thank you guys. I had to go back and retrieve it. I knew it was gone. I just didn't know where the Lord showed me, and you know, that hole that I was ever.
Praise the Lord. God's good.
Thank you, Lord.
And if I'm reading my paperwork right back there, I should thank the Lord as well, because the church insurance is around $600 a quarter. And I just got a statement from the insurance company itself, saying that it was only going to be $100 and some. I got a $500, not a rebate, but a credit, because they've been charging me for workman's comp, and I keep sending it every year. They ask me for updates, you know, and you have to give them all this stuff all over again, and I did it again this year, and I said, there are no employees. We have no employees. So hopefully that finally sunk in, or somebody actually read the letter that I sent back. But anyway, from what I'm seeing, I'm only paying $100 this quarter instead of $600. So thank God. Thank you, Jesus. That's like a $500 gift. Praise God. Okay, let's stand and go to the Lord in prayer with all of these needs. Father, you've heard every situation and every circumstance and every individual. And you knew all of these before we even brought them up, but you ask us to ask you to involve you, Lord, in all of these situations and circumstances. These are desperate situations for each of these people, as you know, Lord. And Lord, we just release our faith for your power and your anointing to move and to touch each one of these people at their greatest need, Lord. Because you know that better than we, Lord. You know the deepest issue in their heart. And so we ask you, Lord, to minister to those needs as only you can by the power of your Spirit. Let your love, your peace, and your reality flow to them. Let them experience a revelation of your goodness and your grace. And for that, Lord, we're going to give you all the thanks and the praise. We look forward, Lord, to the testimonies that will come, that people have been experiencing your great grace and your love and your peace. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. James, would you do me a favor and come take up the offering tonight? Thank you, brother. While James is coming up, we do have some announcements. If you have a cell phone, please turn it off, or, you know, put it on buzzer or whatever. I got a, pardon the expression, a butt dial from my daughter in New Jersey at 4 o'clock in the morning a couple nights ago. It was really bizarre, but, and then she called me back and apologized for the call 15 minutes later, but she works weird hours, so, and of course it's Jersey, it's like 5 o'clock out there. But anyhow, Eastern Gate House of Prayer, June 9th, it's, I'm reading in Greek right now, so just bear with me. June 9th. June 9th. The font just threw me for a moment, okay? June 9th, 7 p.m., Eastgate House of Prayer, come. I know Mike already mentioned earlier they're going to be doing some declarations over the city, over the violence and the shootings and other situations, as well as their usual just being led by the Spirit. So if you can be here, be here. Remind others and get them involved as well. It's a good thing. Praise the Lord. And then the church picnic is going to be 1 p.m. June 10th at our house. And bring your own lawn chair. That's for insurance purposes. Nah, I'm just kidding. Just bring your own, because we don't have enough. And sign up back in the foyer. And everybody's invited, okay? So just all you got to do is just bring a lawn chair and bring a salad or some fruit, vegetable, whatever, a side dish. We'll supply the meat. And we'll get the address out to everybody between now and then. And if you're not here, don't happen to be here when that address is given out, you can call us or call the church or call Mike or somebody, and they'll have it. If they don't have it yet, they will have it then, okay? Yeah, please call Mike. All hours will be fine. Right. So June 10th, 1 o'clock. There you go. June 10th. 1 p.m. Now, if it rains, we're going to have it the 17th. We'll just be a week later, okay? So that's the intent, and I guess that's it, right, Sally? Okay. Praise the Lord. All the announcements. All right. James, would you like to pray for this offering? Appreciate it. Amen. God bless you, James. Thank you, and God bless you as you give. Praise the Lord. The worship team, abbreviated, comes. We'll worship the Lord. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Thou my Redeemer, O Lord of my
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just bless you this morning or this evening, and thank you, Lord, for your blessings, for your goodness, for your favor. Thank you for your great love wherewith you've loved us, Lord. We just bless you tonight and praise you, Lord. I ask you, Lord, to just be a part of the remainder of this service, Lord. Show yourself mighty on our behalf. Speak to us, Lord, through your word, and we'll give you the thanks and the praise. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Suzanne. Thanks, James. Praise God. God is good. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Well, it is Wednesday night, so my intention is to be brief, and so you can get out of here at a reasonable time, get home and relax before you have to get up and do it again tomorrow. Praise God. I had a phone call before church, and lady with some serious personal issues, and the sad part of it is that the conversation she shared with me isn't unlike many that I have with people, and it's because they have a confused image of God, and because of that, they have trouble believing God for breakthroughs in any area of their life. They're just not convinced that God's love for them will overcome any failure, any situation, or any circumstance that they might find themselves in. Because we live in a world that has a tendency to make love a reciprocal thing and about, you know, you do for me and I'll do for you, and if you don't do it the way I want it done, then I'm going to dump you or reject you or find fault with you or whatever. Experience that enough, and then you start distrusting everybody and everything, including God. So that's what I want to talk to you about briefly tonight. And if we can, Mike, let's start in Matthew chapter 7. We'll read verses 24 through 27. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. The rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. Verse 27. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Praise the Lord. So, my younger grandkids are in the Lego stage, have been for a while. And we've been traveling that painful road for a while now. And you say, well, painful, what do you mean? Well, have you ever stepped with your full weight on the pointed edge of a Lego, hallelujah, unexpectedly? It'll get your attention, and it'll try whether you're really saved or not, praise the Lord. But building is the fun part when it comes to Legos, and there's endless possibilities. They get to use their imagination and just dream up all sorts of things. Sometimes you don't have a clue what it might be, but other times it does vaguely resemble something structural. But you follow the instructions or you just get creative. And at their age, instructions are just a waste of time because they don't want to look at them. They couldn't read them if they did see them. And they don't want to listen to me anyhow. So, you know, Legos can be, they can be moved. They can be added to. They can be removed. They can be placed. And they can be replaced. But when the grandkids play Legos, inevitably the moment of weeping and gnashing of teeth comes. Throwing a little biblical verbiage here. But it doesn't happen in the construction stage. It happens during deconstruction. The deconstruction isn't usually a gradual, you know, methodical kind of procedure or process. It usually happens in one swift, sudden motion. One of them goes on a kamikaze mission and destroys what the other one worked so hard to build. Then the voices get raised, angry words come out, and tears flow. And then comes a rebuilding effort. And rebuilding isn't as fun, but it's most often necessary. Let's look at Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. Galatians 1, 6 through 11. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which ye have heard, or which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that we ye have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men. So, here's the thing. If people follow anything other than the true, authentic Jesus, then somebody's got to get into a deconstruction program and reconstruct their image of him. And that's really what we're called to do as Christians, whether we actually understand that or not. Because whether it's another denomination, another belief system, or people that are outside of the body of Christ, they all have an image. They all have some preconceived idea of what this Jesus is. Look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, a counterfeit Jesus needs to be taken apart and properly put back together. Praise the Lord. And what makes the process so difficult is that we build him. I didn't think I'd get an amen there, but I was hoping, praise the Lord. You built yours and I built mine. And they built theirs. Maybe that's why when it comes to religion, witnessing Jesus or revealing Jesus or sharing Jesus has never seemed much of a challenge. Because witnessing, by that I mean revealing him, showing him to someone. It isn't difficult for religious people because your Jesus always agrees with you. Praise the Lord. I talked about this a couple of weeks ago and got a similar response. But come on, look, we might as well be honest. We know you can go to any denomination and you're going to get a different Jesus probably. I mean, there's going to be parts of him that are not the same as, you know. And so my Jesus always agrees with me. So it doesn't matter what you say, right? See, the question in our relationship with Jesus is who's revealing who or whom. And sometimes we get confused and make it about us instead of about him. See, real Jesus resigns himself to kind of stay in the background and watch. He loves you. He's actually fascinated with you.
Yes.
But he won't spend a minute revealing you. Watch much Christian television, you see a lot of revealing, but very little of Jesus. Praise the Lord. It's about my ministry, you know, or this thing or that or the other. But Jesus isn't interested in revealing us. He's interested in us revealing him. Praise the Lord.
All right, Matthew chapter 7. Let's go to verse 1, and we'll read verses 1 through 11. Matthew 7 again, verses 1 through 11 this time. Judge not that ye be not judged, for with what manner, with what judgment you judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye mete it, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that's in your own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thy own eye? You hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of your own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast the mote out of the brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample it under their feet and turn again and rend you. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you, whom if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father, your Father which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? Praise the Lord. So now, in our spiritual construction or our rebuilding, it can't happen without honest admission. God is love. In spite of whatever you've experienced in your life in terms of rejection or unrequited love or love that's gone bad or love that just, you know, took a bad turn and went ugly and turned into hate or bitterness or whatever, God is love. And we cannot judge God the way we judge ourselves. We can't measure God or reveal God as just a really good person, because he's way more than that. He's perfect. He's righteous. He's holy. He has made us righteous. But we're still flesh. We still have some issues, amen? And so we have to make the distinction between spiritual and flesh. Whereas with God, there's only one identity here. Love, mercy, grace. He loves everybody, not just the ones I love. I can find flaws in everybody, amen? But God doesn't look at us the same way we look at each other. He says, okay, if he's telling me, don't judge other people. He's not telling me to do something that he's doing. Right? I mean, he's not saying don't judge because I'm going to do the judging. No, Jesus said himself, I didn't come to judge. I didn't come to condemn. I came to set people free. So if we're focused on somebody's flaw, we're not revealing anything about Jesus, no matter how sincere we might be about that flaw. Our responsibility is to love them and let the Holy Spirit deal with their issues, amen. Love them through the issues. You don't have to let them use them against you, if you understand what I'm saying, if it's something evil. But you still have to love them, forgive them. Leave it in God's hands, praise the Lord. Let him be God, praise God. And we'll just be the revealers, which is what we're called to do, right? So if when you mess up, you're expecting judgment, or the people you're sharing this real Jesus with are expecting some sort of judgment, or God's going to withhold his favor from them, or he's going to withhold his blessing from you because you're not perfect. There needs to be some deconstruction and some rebuilding. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. If we got a problem believing that God's going to love me even when I'm a foul up, then I need to deconstruct some stuff in my way of my image of him and reconstruct it, right? It's not easy because most all of us come from some other kind of religious background, some other denomination or what have you, and we've got a lot of faulty building program that went on in our lives, and then we come to a real revelation of Jesus, and we realize, hey, this thing isn't lining up perfectly here. There needs to be some things deconstructed and a rebuilding program, amen, so that God can be who God really is in our life, so that we can then present him to other people in the reality of who he is. Not our religion, amen, not our denomination, not our doctrines and our creeds, but our real interaction and our real experience of God himself, amen? So, if you built your faith on grace, on truth, on love, on God's forgiveness and his mercy, then you've built a real Jesus. Amen? Everybody see Build-A-Bear? My son I'm telling you the truth. My son in Missouri, when they were still living in St. Louis, he worked for Build-A-Bear, didn't he, Sally?
Yes.
For a short time. Praise the Lord. He was doing computer stuff for him, but that fascinated me, you know, build a bear. Praise the Lord. Well, that's kind of what we're doing here. We're building Jesus, right? And it's way more serious than build a bear. Praise the Lord. Because, you know, your bear might be a little lopsided or, you know, cross-eyed or have a limp or whatever. It's important that when we build Jesus, we build the real Jesus so that people can see who he really is and what his reality is and wants to be in their life. Amen? You build a real Jesus, and then your life, your faith, is based on a true foundation. Now, we don't want to give something to other people that's going to be a faulty foundation. Amen? We need to have them understand, as well as ourselves, that we have to be built on a solid foundation. People who don't really know Jesus, and all they know is what religion has taught them, have a tendency to either ignore him or deny him.
Right.
All right, let's go to Matthew again, now 7, verses 24 through 27, where we were to begin with, I think. Matthew 7, 24 to 27. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew, beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Well, I can guarantee you this, one of these days, houses are going to come crashing down. Mm-hmm. And when those houses fall, they're not going to be rebuilt because it'll be too late.
Right.
Praise the Lord. You know, Roberto had a great testimony. He, in his mother's church in Puerto Rico, there was a woman, I believe it was a woman, but regardless of the gender, person came elderly, had rejected Christ all of their life, came up. The pastor had just changed the order of the service to where they weren't having altar calls at the end of the service for a while. So this person who had rejected Christ all of their life came for that one reason, for an altar call. And so he was getting ready to dismiss the church, and the person raised their hand and said, well, aren't you going to have an altar call? And he said, well, yeah, we can have one today. We'll have one today. So he had the altar call. This one person came forward. He said, if you want to receive Jesus, just pray with me, and God will honor your faith, and you can be born again. He prayed a short prayer. The person repeated the prayer and fell out. Now, everybody in the church thought the individual had fallen or been slain in the spirit. The person died. The minute they had received Christ, they dropped dead. Now, that's the goodness of God. That's the mercy of God, the long-suffering and patience of God. But there are a lot of houses fallen that are not going to get rebuilt because people never came to that place where they really trusted Christ, where they really believed. Because of the image that has been presented, the false image, there's people collapsing. There's houses falling that are not going to be rebuilt because life will send a storm, I promise you, multitudes of storms in your life that can cause you to fail, just like the young lady I was talking to earlier, several attempts on her own life. You know, I mean, this is the world we live in. It's filled with stress. It's filled with fear and terror and all the other stuff that we all know about. Amen? And if you don't have a good foundation, you can get shook loose in a hurry.
That's right.
Amen? We've got young people growing up right now that have no connection with Jesus at all because everything they've ever heard about Jesus was this judgmental, critical, you know, get even kind of get you... first chance he gets, like it's all about just trying to catch you screwing up so he can zap you. It's a lousy image of Jesus.
Yep.
And that image will cause you to collapse, praise the Lord. We need to do some rebuilding, amen, in the way that we present Christ, beginning with ourselves and how much he loves us and forgives us and extends his grace to us. I mean, it's hard to deal with sometimes because I don't even like me sometimes. I know that's hard to believe, but except for my wife, she's amen. I can see she's amen. But, you know, sometimes I just, even if you don't do things, you're thinking, I just really like to just say, you know, what I'm thinking, praise the Lord. And We know, I mean, we know things about ourselves that nobody else knows except God. But God knows things about us that we don't even know.
Mm-hmm.
And that is that even when I don't feel like I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, I still am. I'm still beloved of God. I'm still his child. I'm still his beloved. I'm still embraced by him. I'm still, God is always pleased with me. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Because he's not judging me externally. He's judging me by my born-again experience, and everybody needs that. And they need to know that that's the reality, and that's how God looks at them. God so loved the world, people that had no connection with him. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yes.
How much more then would he want to bless us now that we are believers? Amen? Amen? If he gave us his son, if he gave us Christ, how will he with him also not give us all things? Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And so there needs to be a reconstructing program going on, amen, for people who have just got a bad building going, amen?
Uh-huh.
So we need to work to rebuild the impressions of Jesus, attribute by attribute, block by block, amen?
Amen.
Rebuilding Jesus may be uncomfortable. In fact, I can promise you it will be uncomfortable. It'll be inconvenient. It'll even be frustrating. But believe me, it's well worth all of that. Praise God. Because if it's your loved one, it's your child, your grandchild, your sister, your brother, your parent, your cousin, your relative, your close friend, it's worth it. How much more for God, everyone are his potential children. He loves them all. So it's important to him that everybody come to a saving knowledge of Christ. A real Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
So unless people identify with real Jesus, he can't be revealed. We're looking at a sham. We're looking at some scam, but we're not looking at the reality of who Jesus is. All right, John, Mike, if you would, to John chapter 5, verses 37 to 40. John 5, verses 37 to 40. See, this is a record. I think I drove out two already 15 minutes into the message. Make a note of that, would you, Michael? Praise the Lord. Thank you. And the Father himself, which has sent me, hath borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his shape. Ye have not his word abiding in you, for whom he hath sent, him ye believe not. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And you will not come to me that you might have life. Praise God. They built a Messiah. They built it in their hearts and in their minds. And they had this specific image of what he would look like, what he would act like, how he would lead. They had predetermined and they had precise expectations for him, for who he was, for what he would do. So when the real Jesus, the true Messiah, came, they didn't recognize him for who he was. They labeled Jesus an imposter, a false teacher. Imagine if Jesus walked in and sat in our service. I mean, I've thought about this. Would I recognize? Probably, of course, I say I would. But I wonder if he'd be so radically different than even I have imagined. And I can get pretty far out there on a limb at times, as you might know. But I just think he would shock everybody to some degree. Because we just have a hard time accepting the radical grace and love that he's come to give us. Because we are so judgmental. We are so critical. I mean, even of ourselves. So it's not, it's not a surprise, I guess, that we are critical of others. But Jesus is not. They eventually murdered him for claiming to be God. He was the Messiah.
He just didn't match the one that they had built. Praise the Lord. And worse yet, they refuse to deconstruct and rebuild.
Right.
Jesus is here.
Yes.
But because of the Jesus of religion and the Jesus that they have built, there's a lot of people in this world that label him an imposter.
Right.
He's a prophet. He's just a, you know, a figment of some religious nut's imagination, and, you know, go on and on and on. They dismiss him. And they dismiss him in favor of their own Savior. Works, good works, their religion, the New Age, meditation, atheism, agnosticism. Because they're more comfortable with their Jesus, their building, their construction. It's predictable, it's familiar, so it's acceptable. Okay, last scripture, Isaiah chapter 33, verses 5 through 10. Actually, it's not the last scripture, but it's close. Isaiah chapter 33, verses 5 through 10. The Lord is exalted, for he dwelleth on high. He hath filled Zion with judgment and righteousness, and wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times, and strength of salvation. The fear of the Lord is his treasure. Behold, their valiant ones shall cry without. The ambassadors of peace shall weep bitterly. The highways lie waste. The wayfaring man ceaseth. He hath broken the covenant. He hath despised the cities. He regardeth no man. The earth mourneth and languisheth. Lebanon is ashamed and hewn down. Sharon like a wilderness, and Bashan and Carmel shake off their fruits. Now will I rise, saith the Lord. Now will I be exalted. Now will I lift up myself. He says ambassadors are weeping. How many of you know we're ambassadors?
Hallelujah.
Their eyes have been opened, and they're weeping at the picture that is prevalent in terms of who God is and what his reality is. Praise the Lord. Look at 2 Corinthians now, Mike, chapter 5, verses 20 and 21, which is where we'll see this. 2 Corinthians 5, 20 and 21. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Praise the Lord. That should be our witness. Hallelujah. He became sin so that we could become righteous. We didn't do anything other than just accept the fact that he's done it. We have received the finished works of the cross. Amen. Last scripture now, 2 Corinthians 6, verses 1 and 2. We then, as workers together with him, beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation.
Yes,
praise the Lord. So our job is critical. It's critical for the real revealing or revelation of Jesus. Without real identification, there's no real Jesus.
Right.
No real acceptance. No revelation. No salvation. It's that important.
Mm-hmm.
That we deconstruct all of these phony, false images of Jesus and reconstruct the true one in ourselves and in everybody that we come in contact. And you can't get too crazy when it comes to how much God loves them, how much his grace is sufficient for them. No matter how fouled up, no matter how screwed up, they make decisions knowing when they made the decision it was going to be a bad thing.
Right.
And did it anyway. But God still loves them.
Yes.
God still wants them. Some people are like some grandchildren. They've got to be loved extreme. Because they'll push you as far as you can go to get angry, to get reactionary. You know what I'm saying? Because they, for whatever reason, their little personality is such that they need to constantly affirmed. that I'm loved, that it's okay, that they really, the Popo really loves me. You know, he's not just saying that. He really does love me, even when I'm a little brat. And sometimes they'll be the biggest brat possible just to test the reality of your love. Do you really love me? I'm just being honest, you know what? And human beings, adults, can be very same way when it comes to God, because they've experienced so much rejection and so much self-doubt and so forth, that they really need to see the magnificence of God's love, the totality of his favor and grace toward them. That's what we have to give them. Praise the Lord. And people will come to Jesus. They'll be drawn to that Jesus, because that's the real Jesus. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all tonight. Appreciate you being here so much. Have a great evening. Enjoy the rest of the week.